What is the difference between a Buddha and one who is not a Buddha? Difference between one who has blossomed, who has attained to his Buddhahood, and one who has not yet. One of the Zen masters, Heckman, says that all beings are in the beginning the Buddhas. We are all Buddhas. Then what is the difference between a Buddha and one who is not yet? Heckman says in his Songs of Meditation, it is like water and ice. Apart from water, no ice. Outside living beings, no Buddhas. Not knowing it is near, they seek it far. It is pity. It is like one in water who cries out for thirst. It is like the child from a rich house who has strayed away among the poor. The cause of our encircling through six worlds. The cause of our encircling through the six worlds is that we are on the dark path of ignorance. Dark path upon dark path treading. When shall we escape from birth and death? The Zen meditation of Mahayana is beyond all praise. Indeed, all seeds have the capability to become flowers, but not all seeds become flowers, because between the seed and the flower there is a process. Sufis call this as tariqat, the way. If a seed remains on the shelves of the store, it will never know its flowering. It will never know its seed, its essence. Such is the case of all beings who are like the seeds of awakening, but the process has not begun. It is like water and ice. Ice is frozen. The frozen ice has its utility, but it has no fluidity. In order for it to flow, the ice has to melt first. Then it will begin to flow. And when the water flows, it takes away with it many impurities that are there on the surface. And with the flow of the water, as the time flows on, all that is on the surface settles down. The water becomes crystal clear. And when this water is put to boil, the process of steam formation begins and water begins to evaporate, and then it disappears in the unknown oblivion, leaving no trace behind. These are the three stages of water: the solid state, the liquid state, and the gas stage, as the chemistry uses the terminology. In the world of enlightenment, the terminology is slightly different. Ice is the state of an individual in whom the emotions are frozen, one who is on the dark path and of ignorance and continues to live our life and continues to live circling through the six worlds, the worlds of negativities, the worlds of ignorance, the world of darkness, the world of ego. And then the examples that Hackwin gives are beautiful. Then he is like the fish that is in the water and cries out that it is thirsty. You have everything within, but you have not yet started looking for your treasures. It is like someone who is not aware of his capabilities and laments. One has to look within. Look within his own capabilities to see what capabilities an individual has. There is tremendous energy that is there in you in stored form, in its frozen form, but you have not learned the process, the art, the way, the tariqat to allow this energy to become flute-like. There is tariqat, there is a way to attain to that state. Although it is in frozen form, but it is of no use to you. When you buy any frozen item, frozen foods, in that state you cannot consume it. You may have frozen food, but you cannot eat it and you will lament that you are hungry. Then someone suddenly tells you, allow it to defrost, put it on the fire, it will become ready for consumption. Such is the situation of those who say that we are all Buddhas from the very beginning. Indeed, you are a Buddha from the very beginning, in making, in its essence. But the Buddhahood in essence and Buddhahood in reality are two different things. When someone asked, what is your philosophy? What is your way? Buddha said, I eat when I eat. I sleep when I sleep. The man said, this is what we all do. Buddha said, how many of you are aware of it? The seed that you are, you continue to live your life out of ignorance, circling through the six worlds of darkness. And you are on the dark path of ignorance. Dark path upon dark path treading. When this inquiry comes, when shall we escape from birth and death? In that state, when you are circling out of your ignorance, living the life of ignorance, absence of light, None of your actions are guided by awareness. Continue to live your life negating that which is. Firstly, we have to remember that we are part of one synergistic harmony. The current that flows in you flows in the other also. Look at our day-to-day life. We continue to get angry, negate all that is. We face problems in our day-to-day life, but never try to go behind all this. You are driving a car on this highway. Your window is up, air condition is on. Someone gives you a bad drive. Sitting within your car with the windows up and AC on, you make faces and speak out the words that the other does not hear. You consider it to be your way. Is it the way of Buddhas? When Gautam Buddha one morning went to a village where he was not scheduled to go, as Buddha reached, the sermon began. Out of the crowd, a man came, and as Buddha was speaking, the man first paid no attention to Buddha and continued in his prattle. Then he abused Buddha. Finally, when nothing happened to Buddha, he spit on Buddha. When nothing happened, the man spit on Buddha. After that, Buddha asked the person that if you want to give something to a person and he does not want to accept it or he does not need it, what would you do? The simple reply is that the person will have to take it back. Buddha said, so too, I don't need your abuse and curse, you take it back. Anand, who was Buddha's shadow disciple, was there, and he said to Buddha, this is not the way of Buddhas. You are such an innocent person who has not harmed anyone, and this man has been abusing you and he spit, and instead of all that you said to the person that it is because of him that you have been to this village, and if he is finished, then Buddha can leave. Anand said, so. And when you look at the statement of Anand, is it the statement coming out of a Buddha? Buddha said, Anand, this man has not said anything to you. Why are you opening an account? Do you know why have I come to this village? I came to this village only because of this man. I know all my previous accounts, my wrongdoings, the doings out of ignorance, doing while circling through the six worlds of ignorance. Now that I have attained, in order to attain the total freedom, I have to free myself of all the previous accounts. It is because of this person that I have come to this village. I had an open account with this man. I have to clear it. And if I had remained speaking out of my ignorance and forgetting my Buddha nature, I would have created more accounts. And remember, my life is coming to an end. A Buddhahood means there is no more life after that. How will I attain to totality, the beyondness? How can a Buddha attain to totality and beyondness if he continues to act out of ignorance? If he continues to act out of ignorance. This is the difference between a Buddha and one who is not a Buddha. Anand is not a Buddha. He is speaking what he is seeing. He is speaking out of his love for Buddha, not out of his awareness of Buddha, not out of understanding of Buddha. He is not as yet a Buddha. Although in the seed form he is Buddha, but the Buddhahood has not attained its fruition in him. So when Hakuin says that from the very beginning we are all Buddhas, he is right in his way. But that is not the final statement. And that statement should not be taken by the ignorant one saying that the Hakuin says that you all beings are in the beginning Buddhas. Yes, all beings are the seeds of Buddha. All beings are the potentiality of Buddha. All beings are capable of being Buddha one day. Many years ago, many lives ago, Buddha narrated an incident. He went to meet a Buddha called Dipankar Buddha. Dipankar was sitting down. Gautam was not enlightened then. He bowed down to Buddha, and the moment Gautam bowed down to Dipankar Buddha, Dipankar Buddha got up from his seat where he was sitting, and in turn he bowed down to Gautam, who was not enlightened then. This baffled Gautam, and then he asked Dipankar that, "My Lord, you are an enlightened master and I am not enlightened. When I bow to you, it is acceptable, it is understood. And I cannot understand why an enlightened master is bowing to a person like me who is not enlightened." Now, Dipankar says, he speaks the language of Buddha. He speaks the language of understanding. All beings in the beginning are Buddhas. You are the seed of Buddha. And I am seeing in you the fruition. And the day you will attain to Buddhahood, I will be no more. And who knows, this opportunity may come again that you will visit me or we will meet. That is why I am bowing to you. Many lives after, when Gautam attained to his Buddhahood, attained to his enlightenment or Nirvana, he looked into a particular direction. He remembered the words of Dipankar Buddha then, and he bowed down in that direction. Then he understood the message contained in the words of what we are talking, what I am explaining to you, the words of Hakuin, the song of meditation, a very beautiful, very crisp, very precise message, the song of meditation. He does not call it words, he calls it song. In song we can say things which are not possible to say otherwise. Because song emanates out of heart. It is an overflow of emotions, understanding and awareness. And the seat of all this is your heart. That is why Hakuin calls it song of meditation. It is like water and ice. You do not see the intrinsic quality that ice has the same quality as that of water. But in its present form, it cannot absorb anything. In order to make a sugar solution, you cannot use ice because the sugar will not melt in ice. Because of the coldness, temperature, the ice, the sugar will not melt. For this, first the ice has to melt, attain to its fluidity, then acquire a particular temperature. Only then the sugar will melt in it easily. This is why when we are making a brine solution, sugar solution, we take the water at the room temperature. It has the capability to absorb all that is. So first of all, your ice has to melt. It has to attain to room temperature so that it can absorb all this. All the negativities, all that is unwanted. So too your energies, which are naturally becoming anger, frustration, and all these things have to become fluid-like, so that as the flow begins, all that is unwanted is swept away with it. Water becomes your consciousness, your energy becomes crystal clear. Instead of becoming anger, instead of becoming frustration in any particular circumstances, it remains crystal clear of anything. It remains just crystal clear flowing. Then that can give you tremendous energy. And remember, it is the energy that brings the fruition. The energy can come from the food that you eat. It can come from emotions. It can come from your understanding. And when there is such a state of awareness, then you understand that outside living beings, there is no Buddha. Buddhahood, outside living beings, no Buddha, means Buddhahood is your inner nature. It is your awareness. It is your inner flowering, the growth from within. It is not outside. The next line says, not knowing it is near. It is part of you, it is within you, it is you. But you seek it afar. What a pity, Hakuin says. It is like the one in the water who cries out for thirst. Such is the situation of the ignorant one. Buddha never laments over any situation. Then he goes on giving the similes, the examples. It is like the child from a rich house who has strayed away among the poor and then complains. It is his own decision that he has strayed away from his rich house amidst the poor. You are the storehouse of the tremendous energy and awareness because you are the Buddha seed form. But the process has not begun. The process has not begun as yet. So what happens? When the problem comes in, you lament. You run to this one or that one for seeking the help. To the priests, to the politicians, to this one and that one, not knowing that you have the energy within. You have the capability within to go beyond a situation. It is for your mind to suggest the problems, and it is the heart to find the solutions. It is in the state of your inner silence, in the recess of your being, in the inner sanctum, in a state of meditation, that you can find the solution to all that you have been seeking outside in the outer world. It is the cause of our circling through the six worlds is that we are on the dark path of ignorance. We have negated our treasures. We are not aware of it. We do not know what we possess, what we are capable of. Then you are circling in the six worlds. It is like the dark path of ignorance. Dark path upon dark path treading. This process will continue. This process will continue until the tariqat, the way, begins your way. There are many paths, but you have not yet begun to walk along the path. Remember, first you have to walk through a path. Then the path becomes you. You and the path become synonym with one another. And when this inquiry comes, when shall we escape from birth and death? That is the point when the Hequin says Zen meditation of Mahayana begins, and you realize it is beyond all praise. Then continues to explain the various stages of meditation, giving and morality and other perfections as you considered the way, as these are considered as the way of the so-called religions, giving and morality and other perfections, taking of name, repentance and discipline, and many other right actions all come back to the place of meditation. All come back. After all that encircling, you go into this morality, immorality, the dualities, perfection, imperfection, repentance, various disciplines, thinking of right actions, all come back to the practice of meditation ultimately by the merit of a single sitting. He destroyed the innumerable accumulated sins. It is the awareness that destroys the sins. When there is awareness, two things happen. Firstly, you will not open any tongue. You will not act unconsciously. And then you will be aware of all that has been accumulated in the process of your ignorance. You will dissolve all that in awareness. Buddha dissolved all his actions of the past that were the cause of his birth and death. Birth and rebirth. What is the cause of birth and rebirth? You go on opening account with someone. Your word is not needed. Your opinion is not needed at that moment. Two people are having an argument. But you unnecessarily indulge in that action. As Anand was doing, Buddha cautioned him that this man has not said anything to you, but you are opening an account. This is called Mr. Unnecessary. We see Mr. Unnecessary all around. They just exist. That is the difference. Buddha acts out of his wisdom, out of his totality, out of his awareness, and you act out of your cultured, conditioned understanding. That morality, repentance, discipline, all these things are necessary. But all come back ultimately to the practice of meditation, because meditation is the ultimate in healing. There is nothing beyond that. By a merit of a single sitting, I speak of awareness when it dawns into you. I speak a ray of light, tears away the girdle of ignorance and darkness. In order to remove the darkness, you do not need high incandescence bulb. You simply need a ray of light, I speak. By the merit of a single sitting is more than enough. He destroyed the innumerable sins. How should there be wrong path for him then? The pure land, paradise, not far off. The life of bliss, the paradise that we call blissful. The paradise that we call harmony. The paradise that we call understanding is not far. When in reverence this truth is heard even once, when in reverence out of proper listening is heard even once, he who praises it and gladly embraces it. Two things are important. Firstly, you listen to it, you appreciate it, it enters into you and you gladly embrace it. Then what happens? You have the merits without end. How much more he who turns within. Your journey has begun. There is no journey but the journey within. Tune in within. Tuning in. Begin your journey within. How much more he who turns within and confirms directly his own nature, that his own nature is no nature, such as transcendent vain words. It is difficult to define it, to put it into any definition, to give it a name, form or shape. It is formless, beyond all words, beyond all imagination. This is the state of beyondness, such as transcended vain words. Gate opens and cause and effects are one you realize. The cause and effect are one. A straight runs the way, not two, not three. You realize that it is one way only. The way of meditation, which is the ultimate in healing. With meditation, your inward journey begins. You reach to that inner sanctum where all dualities ends and there is serenity and harmony and oneness and nothing else. There is no going and no returning. You have arrived home, taking as thoughts no thoughts, singing and dancing. All is nothing else but the voice of harmony, oneness. And this is existential, this is truth. You can give it a name, it is unheard, unseen, but it is a realized truth. It is unseen, unheard, yet realized truth. White is the heaven of boundless samadhi, the ultimate in meditation. It is the song of meditation. And then he says, radiant the full moon of the fourthfold wisdom, the fourth dimension. What remains to be sought? Nirvana, the ultimate is clear. Ultimate is clear before him. Then he realizes this very body is Buddha. This very body is Buddha. In your fulfillment, you come to realize the benediction of the existence, the benediction of meditation, the benediction of your Buddha. Hakuin called it song, yet yes, it is song. If meditation is without song, it is meaningless. It does not beat. It has to have a beat. It has to have a rhythm. It has to have. And because you remember, if it does not beat, it does not breathe, it cannot be a song. It is a song and a dance. Sing it, dance it. There is no need to think about it. Then if you think, then you will miss the message. You will miss its content. You will find a song and its meaning only when you are singing and dancing. When the music of life has overtaken you, has possessed you, you are overwhelmed. You have once heard it like the silent notes in wilderness, and the echo continues to linger in your being. This is, in essence, the song of meditation as sung by many, as sung by Buddhas. Only this much for this morning on the songs of echo.